today to celebration. Thank you for joining Joni and me as we go live across America and around the world. And we got a lot of things to talk about, a lot of guests today.
Yeah.
And the first thing that I want to talk about is the fact that this past week has been very difficult on me.
Yes.
Because our dear Rachel Michelle, Daddy's girl, went off to college. So on Wednesday night, there's Miss Rachel. I called her and left her a message a while ago.
Look, that's when she was in Calcutta, India.
Oh, she's
there she was
doing
feeding,
the food thing.
Yeah, doing the food ministry.
So anyway, I think on Wednesday night, we rented the DVD College Road Trip. Mm-hmm. We watched it at our house, and I cried three times. And she said, oh, Dad, don't be so emotional.
Right, that's what she said.
And then at 4:30 the next morning, a light comes on in our room. I'm thinking it's an angel of the Lord himself. And it's Rachel saying, Dad, it's time to get up.
Yep,
we
got
to go on our road trip.
She's got her car loaded, Dan. She's got everything ready to go.
Ready to go.
She's ready to get on the road.
That's right.
850 miles. Not 750, not 650.
850
miles in a Mustang.
And I'm just glad that she had you to help drive.
Well, I don't know about that because we're going from Mississippi to Alabama. And the blue light comes on.
Oh, no, David.
I'm thinking I'm
David.
At Kmart. It's a Kmart special.
Oh, no.
No, yours truly was not breaking the law.
No.
Because I am a Christian. But yeah. I was getting sleepy, and the guy stopped me to make sure I wasn't drinking.
Yes.
I don't do that either, by the way.
Yes.
And
he
so,
was weaving, and Rachel's text me. He's like, Mom, I was asleep, and the cop pulled us over because Dad is weaving. And the cop thinks he was drinking, LOL. You know how they do
lots
that.
Lots of laughs.
Yeah. That's the
but
one.
Anyway, he was the nicest
He was so
policeman.
Nice. He found out that you were not drinking, that you
and
were sleeping.
He gave me this warning ticket, and then, this is so funny, he said this right in front of Rachel. He said, now you can just take this and wad it up if you want to. That's what he said.
He was very nice.
But we got there. It took us about 13 hours.
And Rachel drove.
About 600 of the miles.
Yes.
And you know what I did
most
of the time?
We should give her a hand for that. Go, Rachel. Over 600 miles.
Of course, I listened to all of her music.
Yes.
But I was on a mission from God.
Yes.
Not only to take my dear Rachel to college, Lee University in Cleveland, Tennessee, but also, look what I got.
Oh, yeah.
And I read the entire book in the car with Rachel.
This is a pre-release now.
It
hasn't,
after I left
it hasn't
Dallas,
come out yet. The book's not out
before
yet.
Before I even got to Tennessee, I was still in Alabama.
Uh-huh.
I finished Joni's book. I cried 9 different times.
Aww.
In reading this book. And I already told her, it is the best book I've ever read next to the Bible.
Aww,
and I would say that even if I didn't even know Joni Lamb. That's how great of a book it was. I'm telling you this, you need to go to Daystar.com right now and pre-order yours. I know all of you like a good deal, and if you go and you pre-order it, you get like $6 off of how much it's going to be at the secular bookstores. This isn't a Christian book as such. I mean, this is published by a secular book publisher, so it's going to be at the secular bookstores. But if you go to Daystar.com, you click on the Joni icon, the book, then it'll take you to a website. First of all, there's this right here where Pastor Joel Osteen gives a video endorsement
Joni
of your book.
Joni has been a friend of Victoria and mine for many years. She's a woman of great faith, of great insight. She's multi-talented. We so enjoy watching her television program, and now I'm excited about her new book, Surrender All. I believe if you'll pick up a copy, you'll be inspired and challenged to really become all that God's created you to be.
Well, thank you, Pastor Joel. I didn't know we were going to have him talk, but I appreciate those sentiments. And then you do what to get to the ordering?
You go to the book, where it says the book.
The book, and you click on that.
And then click on buy.
And
then there's the places you can get it.
You click on those, and that'll take you directly to their website, and you get a pre-release special price of $13 and something over the regular $19.95. So I know you're going to want to get this book. It tells a lot of mine and Joni's story, but also 20-something other people's story legends are in there. Famous people, some not so famous. Even Tim Tebow, who was the Heisman Trophy winner last year from the University of Florida, even though my Georgia Bulldogs beat him last year.
Well, it's just lots of stories of surrender. I mean, in personal stories, personal testimonies are always so interesting for people to read. My mother, she got a copy. Come over here, Mom. Hurry, run, run, run. And so you got to read a little bit of it, and you hadn't finished it yet, but you're like in the middle of it?
No, I'm probably three quarters through. Okay.
Yeah, but the husband finished it. The mother hadn't finished it.
And so what was interesting is my mother said, she hasn't seen any of the book, and she said, you know, I was really surprised. She said,
what? She didn't think your book was going to be good?
No, she said, I just thought it was going to be the whole story about you and Marcus. And she said, but it's got you and Marcus's story, but there's all these other great stories in it.
I did.
It really made it good.
I did. Well, I knew it was going to be good. But it is such a book of ministry. I mean, it will minister to everybody in every way. I mean, it's great.
I pray that.
I'm
pray
a little bit partial,
very,
of course, yes. But I have to
I
say
think
it
Marshall,
is great.
I think
well,
is too.
You need to get the book.
You,
go ahead and get it pre-ordered. And as it is, it's a special price. And it comes out September the 16th.
Now, I had to get up this morning.
Early. Yes.
Yeah, so I have already been up since 6 o'clock this morning taking care of our very youngest child who has started her first
That's
day.
That's Daddy's baby.
As a junior in high school today.
Miss Rebecca.
Yes, and I told her, I said, Rebecca, I said, honey, of course she could have, you know, even driven herself. And she says, no, I want you to go with me on the first day so we can talk on the way. So
aww,
I was a good mother, like you were a good dad and rode to Tennessee.
But your drive wasn't quite as long as mine.
It wasn't, but it came early this morning. And I left him, and he was asleep, and I came back, and he was still asleep. So he's, like, all perky this morning. Like
Mike Perky.
Yeah. So anyway, they're all back in school.
Well, another neat thing that we did, of course, this Sunday, Joni and I ministered for Dr. Steve and Rita Ball at Metropolitan Tabernacle in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And on the day before, he and I and Pastor Mitch Maloney of North Cleveland and Tommy Madden, who's the new International Youth Director, we played golf together. Mm-hmm. And so that was a good time. And then Saturday night, Daystar was the only Christian network to televise live the Saddleback Civil Forum on the Presidency. We had been invited to televise it by Pastor Rick Warren, who, of course, is the author of The Purpose-Driven Life and The Purpose-Driven Church. So let's go now by way of video footage and let you see a little bit of what Daystar did of showing the interviews between John McCain and Barack Obama.
First thing, let's just talk about war. As an American, what's worth dying for? What's worth sacrificing American lives for?
Well, obviously, American freedom, mm-hmm. American lives, America's national interests. I was just with my family on vacation in Hawaii and visited the place where my grandfather is laid to rest, the Punchbowl National Cemetery.
Yeah.
And then went out to the Arizona, out in Pearl Harbor. And, you know, you're reminded of the sacrifices that have been made on behalf of our freedom. And I think that is a solemn obligation that we all have. I think we also have forged alliances with countries, NATO being a prime example, where we have pledged to act militarily for the common defense. That is in our national interest, and that is something that I think that we have to abide by.
The Civil Rights Act of 1964 allows religious organizations, not just churches, but faith-based organizations, to keep and hire the people that they believe share common beliefs with.
Yes.
Would you insist that faith-based organizations forfeit that right to access federal funds?
Absolutely not. And if you did, it would mean a severe crippling of faith-based organizations and their abilities to do the things that they have done so successfully. Life is full of anecdotes, and I'm sorry to tell you so many anecdotes, but I went to New Orleans after Katrina. Mm-hmm. The Resurrection Baptist Church, mm-hmm. was doing tremendous work with thousands of volunteers, I'm sure probably from here at Saddleback, coordinating the efforts of thousands of volunteers, including my own church, the North Phoenix Baptist Church, who came from all over America. And various authorities, off the record, told me, off the record, that they were doing so much more good than the government organization said. It was incredible, and New Orleans could not have been on the path, and they've got a long way to go, on the path to recovery if it hadn't have been for the faith-based organizations who are still operating in New Orleans, much to their great credit, thank God.
Well, Daystar was the only Christian network to televise that live, and I'd like to know what you thought about that. Do you think that was good? The Daystar showed it. You think it was appropriate? You believe that Christians should get involved in politics and government? I want to hear your phone calls. I want to hear your emails. You can email me, comments@daystar.com, comments@daystar.com. Well, let me tell you about our special guest today. I'm delighted to have, speaking of Lee University, he and I went to that school, and that is none other than Shane Burroughs. He is now from Goodlettsville, Tennessee, the greater Nashville area. He's going to be singing for us today. Also with us today is Reverend Will Graham. He is the grandson of the legendary evangelist Billy Graham. He's a part of the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association in Charlotte, North Carolina. Philip and Patty Hicks, a Merry Heart Ministries from Branson, Missouri. You've seen him on stage entertaining and also ministering, and he has a powerful testimony. There's a need in your life. Call the number that's on the screen. We'll be delighted to pray with you. And people are calling from all over the world. Here's from the Philippines, from Perth, England, from Bangalore, India, from Switzerland, from London, England, from Canada, from Scotland, from Singapore, from more from the Philippines, from India, from the UK, from South Africa, from Nigeria, Africa, from Kenya, from Ireland, from Saudi Arabia, from Australia, on and on and on. Let's see here. Wow, this is just so awesome. I can't even read all these. It's just tons of people from watching from everywhere. But if there's a need in your life, call the number that's on the screen. We want to pray with you today. Here's a great song by the Daystar Singers and Band entitled, Say So.
Hallelujah, we come to celebrate the redemption that God has given us. Wherever you are in this great, big, wide world, stand up and sing. What does it mean to be saved?
What does it mean to be saved? You said it more than just a prayer to pray, more than just a way to heaven.
Tell us, what does it mean to be healed?
What does it mean to be healed? To be born in His likeness, know that we have a purpose.
To be salt and light in the world.
Salt and light in the world.
Say so.
Come on. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
with Joni Lamb and the Daystar Singers and Band as they bring you their most beloved, most requested songs, all in one best of collection.
They're not just songs, but I believe that every word in those songs really ministers to each individual on their different levels.
From soaring praise to intimate worship, this double disc set will have you singing and glorifying God like never before.
These songs may have different names, they have different lyrics, they have different content, but ultimately when they're about God and when they're to Him, they're connecting you to Him.
Over 20 of the most powerful praise and worship songs available now for you to own. The Refreshing Times Best of Worship. Get yours today.
Well, you're going to want to get it. It is outstanding. It's anointed. It is a blessing. And it'll minister life to you. We're so delighted to have Shane Burroughs back with us today. And as I said, he and I have been friends for many years, all the way back to college days. And he's a powerful singer.
Yes.
Also a wonderful minister. And he's going to sing a song entitled, We Were Made to Worship. Shane Burroughs.
The King. We were made to bow before His throne. He delights when we lift our voice in praise. We were made to worship Him alone. We were made to worship the King. His throne. He delights when we lift our voice in praise to Him. We were made to worship alone. Thank you. dream. There's no one else like you, Lord, to you our praise we bring. You alone are worthy of our praise to you. We breathe.
Mr. Shane Burroughs, ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to schedule him for music or ministry, the website or email address, rather, is on the screen. And contact him, let your pastor know, let your minister of music know. We'll be hearing from Shane again in a few moments. Well, I'll tell you what. Daystar is negotiating to buy a TV station that covers Branson, Missouri. And one of the stars from Branson is here with us today. He and his wife, Phil and Patty Hicks. Many of you have seen him as he's entertained and ministered. And he has an incredible testimony, though, entitled The Cross and the 357 Magna. Please join Joni and me as we welcome Phil and Patty Hicks to Celebration. Phil.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Phil, rather. Patty. Now, I'm not really into guns, but years ago, somebody let me shoot a 357, and I was like, I cannot believe I almost said that. I almost said I was blown away. Oh, well, I don't need to say that. I was amazed at how powerful and how loud. When I pulled the trigger, my hand just went up.
Yeah.
Just like that. What is the significance of the 357 Magnum in your story?
Unlike you, Marcus, I've never shot a 357 Magnum. I was just on the receiving end of a bullet from
that
gun.
So you got
like
shot
that.
By one?
Yeah, and I went deer hunting growing up in Memphis, two-legged, four-legged, but I didn't shoot people. I knew better. But the difference between killing a person with a gun versus your mouth, I later learned. But I was a life of rebellion for 29 years. Didn't have a relationship with the Lord. Parents kept praying for me, though, and they didn't give up on that prodigal. 29 yes. years, Memphis, Atlanta, Aspen, Colorado, wine, women, and song, drugs, religion, no relationship. And 1978, a guy from Aspen said, if you ever want to go to Fort Lauderdale, keep an apartment down there, you're welcome to use it. And I went down intending to spend 2 weeks of fun in the sun, but I met a guy who was staying in the same apartment. He'd been ripped off in a drug deal. And I very naively volunteered to help him recover his stolen property. And I said naive because I was a very naive person. And but as a better laid plans of mice and men don't often work out, this backfired. The guy came home, a gunfight ensued. And I didn't take a gun in there, but I was just as guilty by association. And I'm the one that got the slug. My leg shattered with the 357 Magnum. And then the gun was placed to my head and went click twice. He was out of bullets.
Oh my goodness.
Shouldn't be here today.
Oh my goodness.
God is more than just someone you read about. He's one that covers you and honors the parents of the prayers of your parents.
Yes.
So
you got in trouble with the law.
Oh, big time. They arrested me that night. I very naively waived my rights to two detectives. Gave them a confession on tape to cover for the guy that got away because I didn't want my mom to find out, as if they weren't going to find out. But nevertheless, they had a confession. And then I was taken to another hospital, and I spent 6 months in traction, 6 months in a body cast, waiting trial. And I was led to a personal relationship with Jesus in the hospital bed.
Oh.
Yeah, you can say that again.
That's so wonderful.
Yeah, by some folks from the Evangelism Explosion team of Coleridge Presbyterian Church.
Yes.
And then the Baptists surrounded me, and then it was the Assembly of God. I never knew anything
you
about
were well that. Covered, weren't
Come
you?
Come on now. It was time to party. And they encouraged me along with my dad. We began writing, and his hands were tied, and bless his heart, I'm the one that rebelled against him. But he encouraged me along with others to tell the truth at my trial. And so in a body cast, 9 months later, it was stacked against me in the natural. The tape that I made, the confession, the guy that shot me testified, even though he tried to drop charges, so there was something going on in his woodpile there. But nevertheless, I told the truth because they said, you know, even my attorney said, don't say a word. But I said, no, I've got to tell the truth. And so I told the truth, and they sentenced me to life plus 15 years in prison.
That's a long time.
First offense, you know, just first offense. So we had a good joke that day with the body there that they might make me do the life, but they'll never get the 15 years out of it. But that was already, I had encountered, the Lord had removed the scales from my heart, my eyes, and I had seen him at work. And I knew I wasn't going to be in prison long, but long enough to come to terms with him.
Now, the judge was amazed that you willfully and fully told the truth, and it had an impact on him.
Well, he was a wonderful judge. I've never been in a courtroom scene before. It's pretty interesting. But I'll never forget Judge Joseph Price, who always kept a gun and a Bible on his desk, reportedly, because he had put a few people away. But he said, now, and we had a lot of animated conversation as I laid there in the body cast as the attorneys tried to suppress evidence and go over this and that. And he said, well, Mr. Hicks, do you think maybe Ecclesiastes says there's a time for all season? Do you think this is a time for you to go to prison? And I said, Judge Price, you know, very well could be. And so he was just doing a job. But when I told the truth, as Corinthians reminds us, the Lord uses the foolishness to confound the wise. And it was very foolish of me to tell the truth in the natural. But as we know, God works in the supernatural on behalf of his children. And my telling the truth confounded the judge, and he stopped the trial, and he forgot to read jury instructions. Well, I went to prison with a fresh life 15, went and got surgery on my leg up in northern Florida at a prison hospital. And it was Christmas. I crutched into the maximum security prison at Rayford. But about a year and a half later, a letter arrived, and my entire conviction was vacated. When I told the truth, and God requires us to tell the truth with him, but also horizontally. It was important that I did that. And I didn't understand scripture at that time about obeying him rather than man. I was getting a lot of word in me, but just hadn't gotten there yet. But later on, as we reflected on it, it's because of my obedience to do that, the Lord's word wouldn't return void, and he caused that error to occur. And then we found out the next year, after I was set free, the next year, the Supreme Court changed the law back. And that was like the Red Sea opening and closing.
Philip, when you read that letter or heard about the letter, what did you think? How did you feel?
Well, my roommate, one of many roommates, I said, wow, Victor, look at this. And he said, are you surprised? Haven't you been telling me about what God's doing in your life and all? And so there's surrounded with a cloud of witnesses and all. But I at first, not that I didn't doubt God, I'd been confessing his faithfulness, but you know, when it happens, it doesn't, you know, it takes a little while to sink in. And yet the vacation of a sentence, then it goes back to the court, and then we'll find out what the Lord wants to do. And he, as you know, holds the keys. And so they change it to a 10-year sentence.
You know, and I hope Shane Burroughs will sing that song. Joni and I were talking about it the other day. He holds the keys. And yes, Shane, I don't know if you can.
Yes.
But
yes.
Man, that'd be appropriate right now. I want to show you a picture of Philip in his entertainment costume, accompanied by his friend, and that is Wilbur. I love Wilbur.
Wilbur.
How much does Wilbur weigh?
Actually, Wilbur was 150 at that time, but when the Lord told us to fly him down to New Orleans to bring laughter to the Katrina victims, we quit feeding him table scraps, and he dropped 50 pounds.
Oh,
yeah.
He was on a diet.
Tells a lot to us about table scraps, you know.
Now, Patty, I understood that you always wanted to be a clown.
Yes.
So you ended up marrying one. Tell us about that.
I did. Ever since I was a little girl, I had always wanted to be a clown, and then I met my husband. He taught me everything I know. He actually named me also. I'm Patty Cakes the Clown.
Oh,
and I
Patty
love to
Cakes.
Bring joy
I like
to
that.
Those little ones. I do face painting and animal balloons, and it is such a joy.
Now, when people go to Branson, where can they see you?
Well,
of course, I know you entertain all over everywhere.
Just to qualify that, if we will, we moved from Northern California to the Branson area about a year ago, and where we went thinking that with a hick and a pig is going to go hog wild in Branson, you know. But I think there's a stereotype back there. There's too many hicks. So the doors did not open, but the Lord began to open doors on a national scale for us. Featured in Pentecostal Evangel, joined Coalition of Prison Evangelists here in Dallas area, and we began hearing from God as far as direction, our marching orders, our mission, if you will, as you went on that mission with your daughter.
Yes.
And the door never opened in Branson. We lived right there, near there, but we began ministering primarily in Arkansas because of the pig, love for pigs over there. You know, the show me state, there was more truth to that than met the eye but we're now, we'd already got direction, and especially Patty, her faith has increased so much that we're to go. So we're actually have already moved out. We're homeless. And so we're going coast to coast 1 year to take Mirth and a Message into prisons, churches, and especially the children, the families of the incarcerated.
Okay, so people go to amerryheart.com.
You got it. Yes.
They can find out how to schedule for ministry or to find out where you're going to be ministering or entertaining.
Yes.
Now, I'll tell you what, that's a scripture from the Word of God. A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. And when people won't come and listen to a preacher with a three-point outline and a three-piece suit, they will come and listen to entertainers, especially those that have comedy. Amen. And then the gospel message, the good news, Amen. Comes through. So, Joni, I appreciate that, don't you?
I love that. I love that. And you mentioned that you have a desire to minister to children of the incarcerated. How do you do that?
Well, thankfully, Fawn Schreier, who's the executive director of COPE, who's here today, based right here in Bedford, they've helped us get a networking of people that belong to the organization nationwide, and we've just even found that since arriving here, she's got some contacts for me through different people, and so we're just going to call them. We've already got prisons scheduled for Washington in September, and what we want to do, and if you'd be so kind, let people know if they know of a group where we can minister to their children and families, we're ready, and we're just, in fact, we'll be in Texas for March. Entire month there, but we're going to take it coast to coast. I've got a contact with Prison Fellowship. Of course, they have the Angel Tree thing, but we want to go take it further and expand those borders. And so we're
well. I want to make an announcement here today that has not been announced before. Many of you knew we were working on this, but Daystar has just completed installation of Christian television into every prison in the state of Texas.
Really?
It is history in the making. It's never happened before. It's never been allowed before. 120-something prisons across the whole of Texas with the gospel live. You're going live into those prisons right now.
Amen.
So if there's chaplains watching or the inmates, let them know about Philip and Patty Hicks. They would be tremendous to come to your prison and minister to you. And if you'd like to get this book, The Cross and the 357 Magnum, then the website is there, amerryheart.com, and you'll be able to go to that website and get that book. Philip, God bless you today. I want y'all to come back in full costume and bring Wilbur, and let's just take the whole hour and minister.
Listen, we can just start saying, we want Wilbur. We want Wilbur, yeah.
I want to see Wilbur.
I can't believe he didn't bring, because we've had other animals on celebration.
That's right. Pepper's on here all the time, our dog.
Remember the time we had the big Brahma bull?
Just don't go there. I want to tell that story some other time.
All right, some other, for another day.
Yes, another story.
But we've had camels on here before.
Camels.
Sheep.
Yeah, but we've never had Wilbur.
And lambs.
Yes, lambs every day. You see lambs. Yes, lambs.
Well, when we come back, we're going to be talking with evangelist Will Graham. He is with the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. Many of you know his grandfather, Billy Graham. And he is involved in a tremendous project that everybody's going to want to know about. But we're so delighted that Shane Burris is with us today, my friend from Lee, back then Lee College, now Lee University. And he's going to sing a song with the Daystar Singers. And you know what? Maybe you're in an impossible situation. Philip Hicks was in an impossible situation. Life sentence plus 15 years. But because he was honest, because he, as Joni talks about in her new book, he had surrendered totally to God, God had a key to unlock the door. And today, here he is married in a wonderful family, and God is using his ministry. God can do the same thing for you. He can take you out of that prison house called despair or depression or debt or fear or sickness, whatever it is. And he can restore you and heal you. Worship the Lord with Shane Burroughs and the Daystar Singers and Band as they sing, I Sing Praises.
I sing praises to your name. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name.
Email address. If you'd like to schedule him for ministry, let your pastor or minister music know. He sings, he ministers. He'll be a blessing to your church or your ministry outreach.
Yes,
we're so delighted to have Will Graham back with us today. He is actually William Franklin Graham IV. And this is so cool because he and his wife Kendra have a William Franklin Graham the Fifth.
That's right.
Man, that's a lot to put on that kid. We better start praying for him now. But anyway, Will is an evangelist in his own right. He's an associate evangelist with the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. And just a few weeks ago, he did an outreach in south of Fort Worth, the Burleson area. And we're delighted that he's back with us today. Let's welcome Will Graham. Will, God bless you, sir.
Thank you so much.
And give us kind of a recap of your crusade there in Burleson.
Well, we this late May, early June, we had a celebration there in Burleson at the Burleson High School in Johnson County. And I tell you, it was wonderful. God was so good. We had beautiful weather for that time of the
That's
year
because
it was an outside event. It was the largest one I've done in the U.S. We had a great response to the gospel.
Wonderful.
And it was just great to see how God brought everything together at the end.
Well, you have to come back to Texas more often, see?
Oh, I love Texas. I always want to be
Texas
a Texan.
Texas respond. And, you know, a few days ago, this is so neat, Daystar has been helping to promote a new movie about the life of Billy Graham, the early years. And yours truly, actually, I am in the movie, if you can believe it. I don't say anything, but you see me on the platform in 1934. There I am.
Do
I look like I was in 1934?
Yeah, that's the way they did your
but
hair.
But I was the associate evangelist to Mordecai Ham. He was the evangelist who led Billy Graham to the Lord. And I told him that night, I said, now if this guy stumbles, somebody needs to get Billy Graham safe. So I'll jump up there and take over if he stumbles. But he didn't.
Yeah, because we needed to make sure he got saved that
night. Yes, we did. That's important. Will probably wouldn't be serving the Lord now if his grandpa hadn't got saved. But anyway, that movie's going to be coming out soon. We'll be telling you more about it. And we recently had a pre-showing of it. And Will's aunt, Billy's daughter, Gigi was a part of that there. Mm-hmm. And the guy who plays your grandfather, mm-hmm. y'all look very similar.
What,
tall,
big nose,
handsome.
Big nose, big ears.
No, not at all. So now, tell us about, now this is one thing that I think people are going to be amazed about because, you know, we all love and revere your grandfather and remember the great crusades he's had. But a lot of people realize the last few years that because of his health and all, he hasn't been able to do as much. But the truth is that in the last 6 years, there's been more people saved through the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association than ever before. Is that accurate, Will?
That is. And there's times in this world I want to give up. In the sense of, you know, you see what's on television, it's always depressing. That's one thing I love about your program, it's uplifting.
Thank you.
But when you look at the news, it's just bad news. And I want to give up in this world, but then I'm reminded God hasn't given up. And through my grandfather's first 60 years, we saw 3 million people surrender to Jesus Christ.
Wow.
These are people that recorded their names. And I mean, these are not estimates. These are recorded names that we have on file. And then, but in the last 6 years, like you said, through a project called My Hope, where we take my granddaddy's old sermons, you know, from the 60s, the 70s, and 80s, we dub them in a perfect foreign language, wherever we are, and wherever the local dialect, by primetime television, and put it on air. But we also take a year to work with the local churches and the Christians in that area for them to open up their homes.
Wow.
And so they turn on the television with all their friends and family there. We call Matthew's home, just like in the book of Matthew, where Matthew opened up his home to introduce people to Christ.
Yes.
And that's what they do. And we've seen, we've recorded over 9 million, almost going on to 10 million now.
My goodness.
Of people surrendering their life to Jesus Christ in all
that's
parts
awesome.
Of the world. And so.
Will, that is so incredible. How fulfilling is it for you to be a part of something that's reaching so many for Christ?
Well, I guess my granddaddy's just getting better with age, even though he's not in front of the pulpit. We just take his old stuff. That's what I'm saying. It's a God thing.
Yes.
This is
yes.
God moving. God's yes. working this. There's nothing that we can do to save people, to reach people.
That's right.
It's God that's touching the hearts of these individuals.
And the message of the gospel is timeless and it's
that's
universal,
right.
isn't
sure
it?
Sure is.
Johnny?
Well, tell us a little bit about, I don't know if you shared this last time you're here or not, but how you accepted the call into ministry and did you feel that weight upon you knowing that your grandfather and your father, Franklin Graham, are both right. full-time ministry. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, growing up as a Graham, I've never had any pressure to go into ministry. Matter of fact, if anything, my dad protected us and to the point where he really protected us that no one could even talk to us without going through him. And so after a while, Dad said, you know, Will's his own person. You can ask him now. And so there was never any pressure. And to be honest, I never wanted to be an evangelist. I never wanted to be a pastor. And I tell people God kind of tricked me into being a pastor.
He does that kind of stuff, doesn't he?
Well, because if he told me outright, I would have ran, just like Jonah did.
Yeah.
I would have done the opposite thing.
Then you got swallowed by a whale.
That's right. That's not good news.
Yeah, that's not good.
But God changed my heart, and God gave me a heart of a pastor. Wow. I love preaching, and I was a pastor for 8 years, and I hated to leave. That day I preached my last sermon in the pulpit.
Aww,
that was a tough day.
Because
I love my church so much outside of Raleigh, North Carolina. Mm-hmm. But God was bringing me to work with my father at the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association.
Wow, and so all that was preparation for now what you're doing. Because
yes,
you could
ma'am.
Have never stepped in the role you're in now had you not had that preparation of preaching and pastoring.
That's exactly right. God was molding my heart. He saw the bigger picture way before I ever did.
That's the kind of what he did for me, Will. When I married Marcus, I would just go
he
with him.
He tricked you too,
yes, he did, because if he had showed me, I would have run too. And my name's Joni. That's closer to Jonah than yours is. Yeah. And so, but anyway,
I'm glad you didn't get swallowed by a whale.
I thought that I would just travel with him and support him, you know, pray with people in the altar, sing a song. And then we made the transition into television. And then he said, honey, I want you to be up there with me. And then boy, before you know it, I'm doing my own show. And so, but the Lord
can't. And you tell about this in your book.
I do tell about it in the book, but you know, that's what surrender is all about.
That's
you
right.
don't always, we don't know really what through the telescope of time is going to happen in our life. That's where we have to trust the Lord. But God's plans for us, a lot of times are a lot bigger than what we can imagine.
Oh, they sure are. Always better too.
All right, well, tell us about the initiative for young people and how that's connected to Daniel.
Well, it's the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, along with my father, decided to start a program to reach schools, basically. And it's very hard for adults, and because of red tape, politics and stuff, it's hard to preach the gospel or share the good news in schools anymore.
Oh, yeah.
And so my dad doesn't like that. And so my dad wants to do something about it. So the Lord gave him a burden to train young people. And we've seen over 9,000 of them complete training. Now, this is roughly ages between 9 to 15, roughly. They have completed training, a long course where they study the book of Daniel and the person of Daniel about how to stand in an ungodly age and to share their faith with their friends and family, whatever around them. We've seen over 9,000
wow.
of them complete the training. And so we're real excited about that because we want to see the schools turned around for Jesus Christ.
That is fantastic. And we've got a roll in that tells you more about Dare to Be Daniel. Let's watch this together.
Now is the time for everybody to get involved, to do something to help young people.
The Billy Graham Evangelistic Association is doing something, equipping and fortifying the faith of young people to share Christ with others through Dare to Be a Daniel.
I know that Dare to Be a Daniel has ministered to me, you know, in my life. You know, I find myself being more of a minister to people. I've never really been so bold and outspoken in front of people before.
The Dare to Be a Daniel curriculum leads kids to develop an unconditional trust in God, encourages them in daily life-giving prayer and Bible study, helps them to choose godly friends, and shows them how to effectively and unashamedly share their faith with their peers.
It says in Dare to Be a Daniel to pick godly friends. And since then, I've really been watching who I hang out with.
Well, that seems like a tremendous program. How can people that are involved with schools get this into their school? What do they need to do?
Well, it's designed for churches and stuff like that to train their people, their students, to go back into their schools to be the evangelist. And so, to find out any information about anything I'm talking about today, they can always go to billygraham.org, and there'll be some links on there to go to Dare to Be a Daniel and some different ministries like that.
Now, Joni was asking you a question during the roll-in about your grandfather, and I think that'd be so neat to share with our viewers. So when you first made the decision to go into the ministry, tell us about talking to your grandfather. What kind of counsel did he give you?
Well, I was a pastor already, and then I was talking to my senior pastor. God had called me to come and work and help my father. And so I was typing out my resignation. I was handing it to my pastor, Ron Rowe. And as I was handing it to him, he said, before I accept this, you're going to have to talk to your grandfather. Whatever your grandfather says, I'll do. And so I was like, okay, because I love my pastor. And he's my friend, my mentor. And so I went and talked to my granddaddy. And my granddaddy encouraged me not to go into ministry if I wasn't called. And he wanted to make sure that I was called, not just to come and do this because I'm Billy Graham's grandson.
I can't inherit
a ministry. You can inherit a business, but you can't inherit a ministry. Right. Ministry's God. God gives to whom he pleases. And so I just want to be used of him, whatever he wants me to do, to please the Lord.
Will, what would you say to young people today that they are feeling a call? And they may not know necessarily if it's preaching or teaching or missions or outreach, whatever, but what do they need to do in these early years? Maybe they're teens or they're in college or just graduating. What do they need to do?
Well, I think your book says it all. It's surrender. It's surrender. Whatever that calling is, there's a moment in your time where you just have to say, Lord, I'm yours and I want to be used by you, whatever you want me to do. And so there's just a time of surrender. A lot of people don't surrender. They run like Jonah. Yeah. But they just need to surrender and God will take care of the rest.
Well, I can't wait for you to see the movie about your grandfather, because there's a particular scene in there where he was going to preach his first sermon and he was practicing and he was terrible. It was so funny. I don't know if that's true to life or not. But anyway, you will greatly appreciate it, and so will everybody else who loves Billy Graham, and we'll be telling you more about
when helped him to end up being one of the greatest communicators.
Amazing. Yeah. That's why it's so funny, because there's no way you could ever imagine that Billy Graham wouldn't just been great the very first moment, but he was going around the college there in Florida practicing.
He had to surrender the same way as the rest
exactly
of us.
Right.
Yeah, it was so funny. Well, you know what? Your name may not be Billy Graham or Joni Lamb or Philip Hicks or any of the other people we've talked to today, Will Graham, but God knows your name.
Yes, he does.
The very hairs on your head are numbered. Your steps are ordered by the Lord. He loves you. You're so very special to him, and he cares for you today. I want to give these prayer requests to Will Graham and ask you, Will, to lead us in prayer as we close this broadcast.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Lord, you know these prayer requests here. This person, Kathy and Dorothy and Judy, Lord. Lord, you know each one of their situations far better than any of us here. And so, Lord, we just pray for these people that need prayer, that, Lord, you just intervene in their life. And that, Lord, they'll come to a point where they totally surrender to you. Whatever their circumstances are, that they'll surrender you and they can be used by you to see others come to know Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.